We come back to the issue we started the program with, the president being front and center on a national issue. We talk about the overpopulations of our prisons, the rate of recidivism, sometimes revolving door on this subject. Well, the president didn't just go to a prison earlier this summer. He also spoke out on the issue, and we understand he's going to make it a big part of the last year or so that he has in office. And we heard from Dominic earlier with both Senator Booker and former Governor McGreevy, as well as an inmate who benefited from the reentry program. But let's hear from the president himself. Kimberly Walsh, she was in Newark today, and she has more on President Obama's plan.
That's right, Rich. After a stop at the Drug Treatment Center Integrity House, President Obama made his way over to Rutgers University here in Newark, where he continued the day's topic of conversation, the reentry process of formerly incarcerated people working to get their lives back on track. Obama saying he wants to break the cycle of incarceration.
There are people who have gone through tough times. They've made mistakes. But with a little bit of help, they can get on the right path.
The president addressed a series of criminal justice initiatives inside Rutgers Center for Law and Justice building, which includes the expansion of training programs at five cities, one of them Newark. He's also asking the government personnel office to wait until further into the hiring process before asking job applicants about their criminal histories. And he mentioned several grants to reduce homelessness and other difficulties former prisoners face.
The federal government's a big employer, as you know. And like a lot of big employers, on many job applications, there's a box that asks if you have a criminal record. If you answer yes, then a lot of times you're not getting a call back.
The Garden State visit coincides with the release of thousands of federal prisoners as part of the federal furlough program. The nonviolent prisoners are getting a taste of freedom a bit early by benefiting from the drug sentence reductions. From U.S. Senator Cory Booker to Newark Mayor Roz Baraka and Senate President Stephen Sweeney was a who's who of Democratic officials invited to the exclusive Rutgers event. Many of them say they attended to support the president's initiatives. Reporting for RFL, I'm Kimberly Wallace in Newark.
All right, Kimberly, thank you. Now, you just heard about the president's criminal justice reform initiatives. Now, one of the things he wants to do is reduce the recidivism rate. That's a percentage of people who are rearrested after they're originally released from prison. Now, the numbers, they're pretty bad. 68% are arrested again within 3 years of release, 77% within 5 years. But a group called Hudson Link for Higher Education isn't just trying. They're succeeding at this point, not to jinx them, in bringing down those numbers. We've spent a lot of time on this program over the years profiling what I will say without equivocation is an amazing group. What it does is it provides college educations, life skills, and reentry support to incarcerated and formerly incarcerated men and women, and not on the taxpayer dime. And joining me now is Sean Pica. He's the executive director of Hudson Link. He's a former prison inmate himself. He got a degree while inside, and he can give us an inside perspective on how the system can and should be reformed. And we wanted to ask him the best way to cut down on the recidivism rate, which is in everybody's interest here. Also here, good friends of the program, Shelley Mayer. She's a Democratic Assemblywoman representing Yonkers. And Andrew Whitman, of course, our senior political correspondent. Okay, Sean, let's get the first question out of the way. You got people at home saying, wait a minute. We're helping these guys get apartments. We're helping them with job training. And these are guys who did bad. Why should we go out of our way? Why should the government spend a red cent helping these guys who, in many cases, hurt other people? Why is it in our national interest to do that for them?
As someone that spent nearly two decades in prison, when I went into prison, I made some poor choices. But while I was there, I worked on those issues. I worked on the decision-making skills. I got educated. I took it very seriously, as many of the men and women do. The perception of folks just sitting in their cells waiting for their time to finish is totally incorrect. When I walked out of that place, and by the way, walking out of prison after nearly two decades is as scary as the time itself. But I found that there was a community here.
Why
in West...
That?
Because I just assumed that the community was going to be as unforgiving as like, kind of the perception of, you know, no second chances. But I found in the Westchester area that employees, especially in the social services arena, were very welcoming as I disclosed that I did have a felony background. But I found from my colleagues that were going through the same experience that they were not getting the same treatment. So we really, especially if you weren't in that field. So as folks were either going back to school or looking for employment, what did that look like? What were the challenges they were facing? I've had 5 jobs in 10 years since I've been released, but I've had 6 interviews. And in one of those interviews, as I got to the point where I saw they were clearly interested in hiring me, I said, well, before we go too much further, I do have a felony background. I'd love to discuss it if you're interested. They couldn't look me in the eye after that. It got very tense. And obviously, I never got a call back. So they don't have to physically tell you that they're not interested or why they're not interested. They just don't call you back. That's what we're all up against, checking the box or not.
Explain why Hudson Link, 99%, something like that, of the guys who go through the program come out, and we're talking well over 100 guys now, and women, stay out, while the numbers I read, Sean, 65, 75, depending on the time, a percentage of these guys and women go right back in. What's the difference?
Well, I think the number one piece is it's not just an education we're giving these men and women. There is a community piece that's intertwined in it, and we're creating almost a culture of second chances. So not only do we educate associates and bachelor degrees through some amazing colleges, NIAC, Mercy, Siena, Vassar, SUNY Sullivan, but in the process of doing that, legitimate 2-year and 4-year degrees, the men that have been through it then support the ones that are currently going through it, and then they walk out the door, and the ones that are outside, 404 as of today in 14 years have been released, wow. Everybody's working. So when we have our every other month networking dinner, which is a fancy way of saying we have pizza in the city every other month, some of those men and women are home 14 years, some are home 14 days. We're all in the same field trading resumes.
So is that it? Because if I said more than three out of 4 guys who get out within 5 years are back in, why are they going in unbelievable numbers? Not just going in, but doing things, bad things, hurting people in many cases, and then going back in. Why is there such an unbelievable rate of recidivism when nobody wants to go back to prison? Why do you put that number so high on a national level?
I got to tell you, for the men and women that I work with every single day, and we have almost 400 students currently enrolled in 5 different prisons, we receive no state and federal funding. Every penny is raised privately amongst ourselves. So the students know that this is not some handout, this is not somebody just giving them something, that someone from their community cared enough to make this happen for them. So the idea that they really want to finish this, do well, and give back. They're returning to the communities that they once hurt, but instead as role models, as assets, and quite frankly, they're really good at what they're doing.
Okay, but the guys that weren't in the program, that you must have known people that went back inside, right?
Yeah.
Why in such huge numbers? Is it there's no safety net, no job, no place to go, that there were bad guys inside, just like there were bad guys on the outside? Why are they going back in such unbelievable numbers when nobody thinks going to, you know, a place like a Sing Sing or whatever is any place you want to spend any time unless you have to?
Rich, I don't want to jinx you, but if you happen to be in Sing Sing and you're serving 2 decades, and every day during that time, the officers, the staff, the other inmates are saying, don't bother reading, don't bother trying to get a GED, no one will ever forgive you, your life is over. A lot of folks will just buy in. It's easier to buy into that and just stop trying. And at the end of that 2 decades, you're not really expecting to be out very long anyway.
You know, Assembly, one of the things that I saw Commissioner Bratton say is, all right, we're making this national attempt, and while they're targeting nonviolent drug offenders for early release, he said, a lot of times that's how they'll play it out to put them inside. Is there a part of you that's nervous that this new population is going to be coming back to Yonkers and other cities across this country is going to make the job of law enforcement that much harder?
Well, I think there's 2 things. I think one is the president's, and actually the Congress's, bipartisan release of these federal prisoners is subject to judicial oversight. So it isn't that, you know, sort of the doors were open, which is the way the press is sort of describing it. Judges are reviewing each application, in fact, rejecting, I believe, approximately 1/3 of them, saying that these are individuals who are not appropriate to come back. So while I understand a general concern about it, I think there are some real safety valves in the program to ensure that we're being careful about it. So that's point one. Point two, to the general point, for folks who are coming out without having the educational background that you're describing, and it's such a success story, there are places like the Greystone Bakery in Yonkers, which has made it its business to take people who are ex-offenders who don't have a college degree and are willing to work under the terms they set and give them the first chance at a really good job. And this dynamic bakery, which has social justice as part of its mission, is one, does well in economically, and two, provides a real safety net for a number of these people.
Do you think we should have legislation, because it's been talked about for a long time and even enacted in certain places in this country, a block in the box where you don't have to check off if you're convicted of a felony during the interview process, or at least
the
initial one?
Well, I think what and we just, Mayor Spano adopted something similar in Yonkers. At the very entry point, we ought not to have that. It's a disqualifier to the point of having the conversation. When you get into the job conversation, it may be relevant to the job, and it absolutely should be part of the conversation. You know,
because if somebody's embezzled funds, you don't want to hire them as your accountant.
Yeah, you don't want them in a childcare center. You don't want them in a school. There's a million places. There are other places where, as you pointed out earlier, they actually might want someone with your experience. But I think at the entry point, no, it should not be an automatic disqualifier, particularly if someone served their time. And that's what we're talking about.
Let me, for devil's advocate purposes, take the other side of the argument, because, Sean, you earned, to a certain degree, the life you've lived outside of prison, and people in Hudson Link have too. They work for their education, and there are people in the program in Yonkers that you're talking about who have agreed to abide by a certain set of standards, but that's not the universal prison population.
Right.
And every time, the counterargument to all of these reforms is, look what happens when a violent felon goes free and does something horrible, like we just saw with the guy who shot and killed the cop in New York City. I'm curious what your counterargument is to people who just look at crimes that come from people who have served time in prison and say, well, we can't trust them all. Maybe a Hudson Link program on a wider scale, but what Obama's talking about might be too much for too many people. I'm curious both of your responses.
Well, I would begin by saying that when we look at the 404 men and women that are released, we look at the 400 that have currently enrolled, the other 400 that have gone through the program and not been released, because there's no correlation between going to college and being released. So we have these men and women all over the system. The majority of our men and women are in for violent crimes. The majority of them went in as teenagers. The misconception that, you know, they're older men and women that have made multiple mistakes is not the way New York is built. I shot and killed a man when I was 16 years old. It was a horrible decision that I had made. However, that should not be what I'm based on or judged on for the rest of my life. I served my time. I made some good decisions while inside. I looked at all the factors involved. And now, since I'm home, I've become an asset. I'm on the governor's task force. I work now with the college. I work now for the college program that runs these systems. You have to give people a second chance, and those are the ones that we're talking about.
But Shelley, you know as well as I do that critics are going to harp on the negative examples, not the positive ones. And I'm curious what your response would be to somebody who said, I'm concerned that we may see more violent outbursts just from people who fall through the cracks in the system after their release.
Well, I mean, I certainly understand that, and certainly many of my constituents who, while they do believe in a second chance, they have a fear because of criminal behavior, and they have an insecurity, and they don't want to see it exacerbated, and they're concerned this could lead to it. That's why I think, you know, I'm a very much a believer in a system of laws. It's not perfect. But when you have judicial oversight over who's getting released and you have standards that are judged, for example, if someone's in a halfway house and going to be released early, that's different than when in your mind you think someone who committed a very serious crime is coming right, like day two, coming back into the community. That's not the case. So I think we have to understand the limits of this proposal and understand that it was a bipartisan proposal. It was agreed to by conservative
and as
folks.
The president said, I mean, when you ever have a situation where you have a Cory Booker and the Koch brothers on the same page as this, the math of this, how much does it cost every year to house an inmate, let alone the whole process and everything else? It saves us money in the long run if you give them a skill set, if you get them off drugs, and you know you find a way that they're productive and they can have a roof over their head. Forget about compassion and morality and ethics. It's just good dollars and cents, right?
There's 52,000 men and women incarcerated in New York right now. It costs about $56,000 a year per inmate to house them. And that's if they're not younger or older or have health. That's just an average number. And that number just keeps rising every single year.
All right. Well, we're going to follow this. It does seem that there's some momentum on this, certainly on the federal level and even on state levels to do something about this. But, hey, Sean, keep up the good work.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Absolutely.
Thank you.
All right. When we come back, we'll turn our attention to Albany. Shelley Silver's trial, it starts today. Dean Skelos is starting in just a couple weeks. Two of, as you would say, the three men in a room, famously mentioned by the prosecutor, Preet Bharara. Two of them will be standing trial. So the question is, What does that say about the system in Albany? Shelley and our next guest can help us with that as well.